good evening.
Good evening.
Welcome to the fourth and final presentation on Jeremiah and going into the abyss, and maybe we'll discover today if you get out. So today I was thinking about what we've been through the last 3 weeks, and as you recall, last week, as I was pondering what Walter had been saying, I was reminded of John Donne and his poem that he had written, and how it seemed to me to resonate with Jeremiah. Well, today I thought about another favorite person of mine who's not a poet, but this guy, Andre Agassi. And the reason I thought of Andre Agassi is that, for those of you who know anything about him,
he's a golfer.
Sorry?
He's a golfer?
Yeah, he's a golfer. So early on in his tennis career, this incredibly talented player, didn't have much of a work ethic, and most would agree, and he would agree, that he didn't get to the level that he wanted to get at, and probably could have won more Grand Slam events and all the rest of it. Then he met a guy named Gil Reyes. And Gil Reyes is a trainer. And Andre entered this next chapter of his career where he was a blue-collar lunch pail kind of guy. And his coach at the time, Brad Gilbert, would much later on, after Andre retired, he would talk about how the reason that Andre could play as well in the fifth set of a match as the first is because he had done the hard yards, which meant that he was someone who had developed this work ethic. And one of the things he did in Vegas is, after 2 hours of lifting weights and all the rest of this kind of stuff, he would run up what he called Magic Mountain, which was a hill behind his house, 320-yard hill, and run up it 14 times at full speed. And most of the stories about this is that by the time he'd gone up the 14th time, he would lose his lunch. You know what I mean? That he had taken his whole thing to a different level. Well, the reason this came to mind to me was that I think what our Gil Reyes has done for us these first 3 weeks is put us through the hard yards. As Walter said at the end of the last time, you know, this is tough. So I guess what I'm wondering tonight is whether we will get to lift the trophy of victory tonight. We'll wait and see. Walter, welcome again.
Well, let's pray. It is reported among us that when you came fleshed from Nazareth, the blind see, the deaf hear, the lame walk, lepers are cleansed, the dead are raised, the poor rejoice. But some doubted. The blind see, but we do not notice what is in front of us. The deaf hear, but we do not listen so well. The lame walk, but we keep our limp hidden and suck it up. Lepers are cleansed, but we prefer to exclude all those unlike us. The dead are raised, but we are modern and cynical and do not believe it much. The poor rejoice, but we are not eager to share in justice for the poor. Given our doubt and our reluctance, we continue to say we look for the resurrection of the body and the life of the world to come. We are always eager for your newness, but reluctant. We doubt. We love it the way it was. We fend off newness that threatens and upsets. But having admitted that, we pray, be your true self. Plant newness among us with prospects for shalom. Build us up into a force for generosity, hospitality, and justice. Some doubt your newness, Sometimes we doubt your newness, but not now, because we have seen it and we know it and we trust it. And that is why we pray, come, Lord Jesus, come here, come now. Amen. Well, you all are heroic to have stayed with Jeremiah until this happy night. any comment or question or pondering that you've had from our work that you want to raise or share with us? So, or how do young people say it now? You know, right? Is that what they say? How is that? Something like that? No. Tia was trying to explain that to me, but I don't think I got it. So, what we've done is to take our guide from 1:10, where Jeremiah is given these four verbs, and we've spent 3 weeks walking in to 587, which then happened. And tonight we're going to talk about plant and build. And I've sort of suggested that as a symbolic event, the destruction of Jerusalem may have some kind of analog for us in 9/11. So that's the linkage. I want you to look in the book of Hosea for starters. Hosea's right behind Ezekiel. Well, not right behind, there's Daniel in there. Hosea 6. This text is 100 years before Jeremiah. Hosea 5:14, God says, "For I will be like a lion to Ephraim and Judah. I will tear, and I will go away, and I will carry him off, and no one will rescue, and then I'll go back to my lair until they acknowledge their guilt." Then chapter 6, "Come, let us return, for it is he who has torn, and he will heal." So you get the same thing. He has torn, and he will heal. He has struck down, and he will bind up. Verse 2, after two days, he will revive us, and on the third day, he will resurrect. 2 days and 3 days means shortly. Now, I'm citing that for two reasons. The first one is that this is antecedent to Jeremiah. So Jeremiah is much influenced by Hosea. He must have known this text. So what he's done is to take over that double move. The other reason I cite it is that verse 2 became a very favorite preaching verse for the early church. They loved after 2 days on the third day. So it could be that the calendar of Friday, Saturday, and Sunday is simply arranged according to the imagination of Hosea. They were much influenced by how they put the story together, and that may be the way. But what I wanted you to see was the verbs of failure and then the verbs of revival. So planting and building are imagining futures toward which the covenant people are summoned to act. Now, I underline act. So when you get these wonderful promises of plant and build, they are not simply assurances of what God is going to do. They are summons that you have to live and act toward them. And what we're going to do tonight is to look at two bodies of text. So the first text is in chapter 29 following.
29
Jeremiah. We're back in Jeremiah, yes. And this first text will be familiar to you. It is in verses 1 through 9. It's a very famous text. In verse 3, Jeremiah sent a letter to the exiles who had been carried away in 598, 10 years before. So that's his advice to them before. And what he says is that you're going to be in exile a long time. Get used to it. And then in verse 7, this is a very famous verse, seek the, it's the Hebrew shalom, which is translated welfare of the city of Babylon, and pray for it, for in its shalom you will find your shalom. So you're going to be a displaced people. So verses 1 to 9 are a kind of a segue from all of this stuff to beginning this. And then if you look in 10, verses 10 through 14, what you observe is prose. Verse 11, I know the plans I have for you, plans for your shalom and not for evil, to give you a future. In verse 14, I will restore your fortunes. This becomes a very famous mantra in the exile. I will invert your situation. Where it's been bad, I will make it good. And if you'll look in Deuteronomy 4, hold that, look in Deuteronomy 4 with your other hand. Verse 29, Deuteronomy is easy to find. 4:29, from there, that is, from Babylon, you will seek the Lord your God, and you will find him. If you search after him with all your heart and with all your soul, you will return to the Lord your God, because the Lord your God is merciful and will not abandon you, will not forget you. So back in 29 now, verse 13, when you search for me, you will find me if you search for me with all your heart. So the reason I'm showing you that is that this text is probably not from Jeremiah. It is probably a Deuteronomic text that the editorial tradition put in here, so Deuteronomy 4. But what I really want to talk about is the poetry in 30 to 31. If you look at the beginning of chapter 30, verse 2, thus says the Lord, the God of Israel, write in a book, or we would say scroll, all the words that I have spoken to you, for the days are surely coming when I will restore the fortunes, invert your situation, and I will bring you back to the land from exile. Now, 2 points of interest there. This mention of a book or a scroll, scholars have termed chapters 30 and 31 the book of comfort or consolation, and most scholars believe that these two chapters may originally have been an independent scroll in which the editorial process brought all the promises of Jeremiah and grouped them together in one place. And then I put down the turn of destiny. If you look, you might want to mark these in your Bible. In 30:18, I am going to restore the fortunes of the tent of Jacob. In 32:44, the last verse of that long chapter, last phrase, I will restore their fortunes. In 33:7, I will restore their fortunes. In 33:11, I will restore their fortunes. And in the last verse, 33:26, I will restore their fortunes. So that is kind of the endless refrain of the Book of Covenant, and what that amounts to is homecoming. Now, so you, what I want to say is that in the exile, you get Jeremiah 30:31 that goes on to 33. In Isaiah, you get 40 to 55. We know this because this is the text for Handel's Messiah, comfort, comfort my people, and so on. And then in Ezekiel 34 to 37 and 40 to 48, that's not so well known, but if you look in Ezekiel 37, that's right after Jeremiah, verse 12, I am, thus says the Lord God, I am going to open your graves, and I will bring you back to your land. I will put my spirit upon you, you shall live, and I will place you on your own soil. And when I do that, you shall know that I am Yahweh. Now, the reason I'm digressing to talk about that is that these great promise texts are probably more or less contemporary, though the Isaiah text is a bit later than the others. But what I want you to see is that it is exactly in exile in the Old Testament that you get this explosion of hope and promise and possibility, which is all against the data. The data would have said that the Jews were going to stay in exile forever because they are impotent and they have no capacity to go home. So the promises of the prophets about planning and building are really quite counterintuitive, that God is doing a new thing that means to counter the despair of Israel in exile. So what I want to talk about in this section, I think it's the most interesting text in the book of Jeremiah. In chapter 30, beginning at verse 12, take a look at that. You remember that back in chapter 8, we had that, is there a bomb in Gilead? And what the text said is, you're hopelessly sick and you're not going to get well. So that theme is picked up in chapter 30, verse 12. Your hurt is incurable. Your wound is grievous. There is no one to uphold your cause. There is no medicine in Gilead. There is no healing. All your lovers, that means your allies, your military allies, have forgotten you. They don't care about you. So I underline that. They care nothing for you. And then look at this. You have in the English translation in verse 14, because your guilt is great, because your sins are so numerous. In verse 15, because your guilt is great, because your sin is so numerous, I have done all these things. And I have told you then that the most ominous rhetorical maneuver in the prophets is the word therefore in verse 16. So this is kind of the culmination of saying that Jerusalem has been completely abandoned and it is without hope. Therefore, but if you look at it, the therefore is a rhetorical trick. Because what follows is a non sequitur. Therefore, you see, you have to ask, how did the poet get from 15 to 16? Or if you take this to be Revelation, how did God get from 15 to 16? So when you read this, because verse 16 is such a surprise, you want to do a long pause. If you're reading it in church, you want to do a long, so long that Phil thinks he's missed a cue and is supposed to do something. Therefore, all who devour you, that's Babylon, will be devoured. All your foes, that's Babylon, will go into captivity. All who plunder you shall be plundered. All who prey upon you, I will make prey. Because, I think, translate verse 17, because, did I do that? No, I didn't. Because, or surely, I will restore you to health, and your wounds I will heal. So what I want you to see is that the poem does a complete reversal from incurable in verse 12 to restoration and health in verse 17. And then God says, why I have reversed field. I have reversed field because they, meaning the other nations, you know, the other nations said, where is your God? If you're the Son of God, why don't you come down? Because they have called you an outcast, they said, the nations, oh, look at Zion. Nobody gives a shit about Zion. Oh, nobody cares about Zion. Now, what I want you to notice is that no one cares about Zion. That's what the nations are saying. Is exactly what God said about Israel up here. But it makes a difference if it's said in-house or if an outsider says it. That's how it was at the seminary where I taught. The student didn't like the dormitories, they didn't like the food, they didn't like the teachers, till they got with seminarians from Princeton Seminary, and they said, oh, our seminary is great too. So Yahweh is offended when the nations say that, and Yahweh's response, according to this poem, is, I will not let them get by with it. I will show them who cares for Israel, and I will rescue and heal and save and bring home. I take this as a most extraordinary poem, because right here, the poet, or God, depending on how you take that, does a complete about face. And I think you could say in this one poem that this is plucking up and tearing down, and this is building and planting. And the motivation would seem to be that Yahweh is offended because Israel is being shamed, and by implication, the God of Israel is being shamed as well, and God will not put up with that, so it turns to promise. So if you ask in this poem, what's the ground for hope? The ground for hope is that God can only be pushed too far, so far, and then God will act in a new way. So when you read the Psalms of Lament, the speakers often say, I have been driven to shame, and I am humiliated, and I have become a laughingstock. And that's all an attempt to motivate God to care for me, because I don't have anybody else to look after me, and I am really God's responsibility. So I think this is a wonderful, dramatic example of what you can do in poetry that you can't do in systematic theology. So let me stop to see whether you want to respond to that. Maybe that's all perfectly obvious to you, but go on and on.
But I don't know anything about systematic theology, so tell me what you mean by that.
Well, systematic theology, particularly Presbyterian systematic theology, it's all logical proposition. And what can happen is what's permitted by the logic of the argument, and poetry is not bound by that kind of logic. And I think what has happened in the long history of the church is that liturgy was essentially a poetic performance until the theologians got a hold of it and tried to make it all reasonable and coherent. That's sort of, that's a standard polemic that biblical interpreters do with systematic theologians, so. Yeah. But any good systematic theologian would say, no, that's not what we do. But it is what's happened. Yes?
Could the extreme change from the beginning to the end of that content there be a miracle of the Spirit?
Could be what?
A miracle of the Spirit, God demonstrating that He was punishing them and then forgiving them.
That's right, that's right. The only thing to insist upon, it may be a miracle of the Spirit, but the poem imagined it being worked out in actual public history. Yep, exactly, yep. Well, if you read on through, and I won't labor all of this, if you look in chapter 31, I just wanted you to see a couple of phrases at the beginning in verse 2, found grace in the wilderness. That probably is an allusion back to the manna story, and they were surprised that God's graciousness showed up in the wilderness. And what happens in poetic imagination is that wilderness becomes a metaphor for exile, so you could write exile there and be all right. And then the next lines, I have loved you with an everlasting love, and then you get a therefore. And then notice the series of three agains. Again, I will build you. Again, you shall take tambourines and dance. Again, you shall plant. So you have the first one is build, and the third one is plant. And between them, you get tambourines, because there will be a day when everybody gets ready to go back to Zion in victory.
What are those verses, Walter?
Verses 4 through 6 of 31. Then I want to mention in verse 31, 15, a voice is heard in Ramah, and the name Rachel is an appeal back to Genesis, particularly Rachel grieving over Joseph, whom she thought was dead. But then it becomes a metaphor of Mother Israel or Mother Jerusalem weeping for all the Israelites who had been carried away by the Babylonians. And then the next verse counters that. Keep your voice from weeping, keep your eyes from tears, for there is a reward. And then verse 17, there is a hope. On that text, look in Matthew 2. This is a famous usage. In Matthew 2, 18, this is the Herod's slaughter of all the little boys, which is a replication of Pharaoh. And then Matthew quotes Jeremiah, a voice was heard in Ramah, Rachel weeping for her children. She refused to be consoled. Emil Falkenhayn, who is a great Jewish theologian, wrote not so long ago that after the Holocaust, Mother Rachel is weeping for 6 million of her children because they are not. So you can see how the text uses them. Jonathan Kozel, you know Jonathan Kozel? He's this fierce advocate of our bad schooling, has written a book called Rachel, and it's a case study of a mother in a unbearable school district in New York City, about Rachel weeping over her children because they are daily at risk and some of them are killed and so on. So this verse has incredible futures that go along with it. And then I want to comment on In 31 to 34, what I'm wanting you to see, this collage of poetry, is that the poets use all the images and all the metaphors that they can muster to try to talk about the newness toward which the Jews are now invited. And this is a very famous one. I think we talked about it briefly. I will make a new covenant. So what you have is a broken covenant and new covenant. And if you look back in Exodus 34, this is after the golden calf. And you remember the tablets of the covenant were broken in anger. And then Moses prays to God to forgive and to start over in verse 9. Although this is a stiff, 34:9, a stiff-necked people, pardon our iniquity and take us free. And then in verse 10, God says, I will make a covenant and I will perform many wonders for you. So the golden calf narrative is the paradigmatic narrative of broken covenant and renewed covenant. And this is an endless liturgical performance in ancient Israel, because the covenant is always being broken and God is always renewing the covenant. We take that over with the Eucharist, which is the new covenant festival, and with the confession of sin and the assurance of pardon is the offer of the new covenant when we greet each other in shalom, because for about 3 nanoseconds we haven't sinned against each other, so we can pass the peace. So, that's what I wanted to hear, new covenant. But notice, what Jeremiah says is that the covenant was broken and now is being renewed. And the difference between the old covenant and the new covenant is that I will put my, verse 33, put my Torah within them and write it on their hearts, which means they will inhale Torah and willingly obey it. And then it's all ground in forgiveness. Now hold that and look at Hebrews 8. That's in the appendix. Hebrews 8. Let me start with Revelation and work backward. But look at verse 8:8. God finds fault with them, that is the old priests, the old Jewish priests, when he says, and look at this, this is a quote of the whole Jeremiah passage. It's one of the longest quotes in the whole New Testament. The days are coming, I will establish a new covenant with the house of Israel, house of Judah, not like the covenant which they broke. This is the covenant I will make with them. I will put my laws in their minds and write on their hearts, and they will be my people. And I will remember their sin. And then the comment on it is, in speaking of a new covenant, which the writer means with Jesus, he has made the first one obsolete. And what is obsolete and growing old will soon disappear. So this is, the commentaries struggle with this and find ways out of it, but it seems to me on the face of it, this is about as close as the New Testament gets to supersessionism, to saying that Christian faith has superseded Judaism and Judaism is obsolete and outmoded. So it's taken us a long time to get over that interpretation, but there it is. And this is a rather stunning use in which the early church wanted to say that this text on the New Covenant wasn't really about the Jews coming home from Babylon. It was really about Jesus of Nazareth and the church. So what you get always are two interpretations. And it was not until Vatican II that the Roman Catholic Church finally arrived at a conviction that the old covenant of God with the Jews was not abrogated, but it is valid alongside ours. And a great Jesuit in Germany, Norbert Lofink, wrote a little book entitled The Covenant Never Revoked. So this was a Christian theologian on behalf of the Catholic Church saying that that covenant is valid, and it's bad interpretation to say that it was obsolete. So let me do two other texts here, and then I'll stop with this and see whether you want to respond. In 31:20, I always told my students, when you read a text like this, ask what it must have cost the poet to write or recite these lines. He has God say, is Ephraim, that's another word for Israel, is Ephraim my dear son? What do you think? And then the parallel, is he the child in whom I delight? Well, I didn't think so. And then look at the next verse. As often as I speak against him, I cannot get my mind off of him. Now this is the poet taking us, if you think it's revelatory, taking us inside God's life. And God is incredibly conflicted about this child Israel who has been so recalcitrant. So the image I have of this, which happened in many families, the dad was a World War II veteran, and the son went to Canada to avoid the Vietnam draft. And the dad said, so far as I am concerned, he is dead. He has humiliated our family. I don't want his name ever mentioned again in this house. And then at supper time, he said, did he call? As often as I speak against him, I do remember him still. So the poet is tracking this incredible linkage that Israel has with God, and we would say that the world has with God. So as angry as God gets, God cannot relinquish. Look in Isaiah 49, the same deal with maternal language. That's a father speaking. Isaiah 49:14. Well, I want you to hold Isaiah 49:14 and with your other hand find the book of Lamentations, which is right after Jeremiah. So look in Lamentations 5:20. Why have you forgotten us completely? Why have you forsaken us these many days? See that? Lamentations 5:20. We said. Now, look in Isaiah 49:14. Zion said, quote, Zion said in the liturgy of the book of Lamentations, the Lord has forgotten, the Lord has forsaken. It's the same two verbs. They thought they were abandoned by God. And then God says, can a woman forget her nursing child? No, cannot, or her breasts will hurt. Or show no compassion on the child of her womb. And what you need to know in Hebrew is that the word compassion and the word womb are the same word with different vowels. Rechem and racham. Even these may forget, yet I will not forget you. The mother cannot forget the nursing child. Jeremiah 31, the father cannot forget the wayward son. This is psychologically incredible. So 31:20 continues, therefore I am deeply moved. I am agitated for him. Therefore, I will have mercy. And it's a very intense verb. I didn't intend to do that at the beginning of the verse. But in the middle of the verse, I discovered depths of emotional commitment. It is though God is discovering something about God's self. So the poet imagines. We have that hymn, O Love That Will Not Let Us Go. Not because God is so favorably inclined toward us, but because God can't help God's self. Well, the last business of these chapters that I want you to see is in 35 through 37. Look at this. These are 35, 36, and 37. They're both if then. Thus says Yahweh, verse 35 is the Creator, who gives the sun, the moon, the stars, the sea. If, 36, if this fixed order of creation were to cease, then the offspring of Israel would cease. If my commitment to Israel is as valid as my commitment to creation. And that creation is, you know, it's just pre-scientific, but they thought creation was guaranteed, so Israel is guaranteed.
I'm sorry,
31:35. Did I not say that clearly? 31:35. Jeremiah. Okay? And verse 37 is the same. If, this is pre-scientific, if the heavens could be measured, if the foundations of the earth can be explored, then, not till then, I will reject all the offspring of Israel because of their evil. Now, I think if you look at these two compared to this, these are very different theologies. I think this is Jeremiah's theology. Jeremiah says it's broken and remade. This theology says never broken. So if you begin to pay attention to that, you can see that the book of Jeremiah is a collage of competing theological interpretations. And this one is, I think this one is pretty remote from how Jeremiah talks. But they put it in there and seems to work okay. So what I want you to see about 30, 31, and then if you look in 32, this is that famous land text that we had not long ago in the lectionary. And then 33 is in prose, but it's all about promise and possibility. And then you will notice in 33:14, or 15, I will cause a righteous branch to spring up for David, which means the Davidic monarchy is going to be, this is something Jeremiah probably wouldn't have said. So somebody else said that. And that was one possibility as they tried to think about the future. And then you'll notice in 33:25, only if I had not established my covenant back with Noah, with day and night and the ordinances of heaven and earth, only then would I reject the offspring of Jacob and my servant David, and so on, and I will restore. So what you get are a collage of statements about God's either renewed or continuing fidelity, that the destruction of Jerusalem is serious, but it has not at bottom interrupted God's passion for Israel. Now, one other text, look in Isaiah 54. This would be a little later, probably. Verse 7. For a brief moment, and the word moment means a beat, for a brief moment, I abandon you, but with great compassion, there's that womb word, I will gather you, and then the same thing in verse 8, in overflowing wrath, for a moment, I hid my face, but with everlasting love, I will have compassion on you. So in after 587, what this kind of poetry wants to say is that God is at work in faithfulness to create good for the life of Israel. And obviously then it is a maneuver of Christian theology to say that all of those promises made to Israel have become embodied in Jesus of Nazareth, who is the completion of the promises of the Old Testament. So that's kind of how it works in a Christian perspective. And so we read these kind of stuff in church with reference to Jesus. Well, I'll stop there to see whether you have a question or comment. Yes?
Is the poetry a demonstration of lamentation?
Of what?
Lamentation. It's the poetry sounds to me like lamentation.
Oh, this poetry is probably a very different genre of joyous possibility. It's in response to lamentations. Yep. Right. Yes?
What do the Jews of today think about these promises? What is their conception? I mean, they're not considering Jesus Christ the personification of this. So
well, as you know, there are as many Jewish interpretations as there are Jews. But as you know, the dominant Jewish line is the state of Israel is the fulfillment of the promises. But you probably know that in the 30s and 40s, before the founding of the state of Israel in 48, there was great Jewish resistance to the founding of the state. Foremost among them was Martin Buber, the great Jewish philosopher, who said that if Jews take on state power, they will start acting like a state. And what he said is, we are not a state, we are a covenant people. And of course, the propagandists for the state of Israel want to try to hold all that together. But it would look to me that that doesn't work very well. You recall last week we were talking about the Moses theology and the David theology. If you read the Moses theology in the book of Deuteronomy, what it says is you will lose the land if you don't obey the Torah of justice. So that doesn't get read in Zionism, what gets read in Zionism, is this is an unconditional promise, no matter how we act. So it's always this same tension, and you get Jews all along the spectrum of that. Yep. And you know, in some ways, it's too bad that in the media we only get the Zionist line. We get very little coverage of other modes of Jewish interpretation. You want to say more?
I think it's interesting that Martin
Talk loudly.
Martin Buber, Albert Einstein, both of them founded Hebrew University in the end.
Yep.
So yep. They assimilated a bit to the culture as it developed.
Yeah, of course they did. Of course they did.
Intellectual parallel.
Yep, right.
Earlier you referred to the obsolete old law.
Yep.
Unbeknownst to us, because obviously we're not at the same level you are there many parts of the Bible that you would label bad interpretation? Are there? I'm just curious.
Well, I'm no expert about that, but I think in the first gospel and the fourth gospel, it often talks about the Jews, and we've read that as though it were all Jews are Christ killers, but in context, that usage in the Gospels to the Jews is talking about the leadership that colluded with the Roman Empire. Wasn't talking about all Jews, and I think it depends on how you take those texts. And I think we have in the 20th century, since Vatican II, and since the Holocaust, we've been in recovery from that kind of anti-Jewish reading of the text. So now there is a very different wave of New Testament scholarship arguing that particularly Paul's epistles are really concerned with how can Jewish Christians who keep the Torah and Gentile Christians who do not keep the Torah, how can they live together? Well, that sounds like the Episcopal Church. How can Episcopalians who believe the law dismisses gay persons and Episcopalians who believe that gay persons are enfolded in the gospel, how can they live together? And of course, what Paul's argument in Romans and Galatians is that the church doesn't belong to Jewish Christians or to Gentile Christians. It belongs to Jesus. So it doesn't belong to any of us, even though we act as though it's our church. So let me digress to say that there is a book by a German scholar, it's in English, named Kahl. Did I say this to you already about Galatians? You won't remember it, so I'll say it again. It's called Reimagining Galatians. And you may know that in the book of Galatians, Paul just kind of beats up on the law. We are justified by grace. So we read that as a kind of an anti-Jewish polemic. What she argues with a huge amount of research is that the law Paul is writing about is not the Torah, it's the law of the Roman Empire. And what he's saying is, you're not going to be saved by the law of the superpower. You will be saved by your baptismal identity, which is in tension with the law of the superpower. And that shift has happened in New Testament interpretation just in the last 25 years. So the very new things. If you're interested, I think the most helpful scholar is Richard Horsley. I think he teaches at UMass, and he got a lot of books out, and they all move in the same direction about this. So you can argue that the church has been on a mistaken reading of this stuff since Luther, because Luther struggled with his own sense of guilt in a church that wouldn't forgive him. And then, you know, nothing wrong with that. But then what we did was to turn Luther's personal spiritual pilgrimage into absolute theology. And you can't absolutize that way. So I think that's not in the Bible. That is a reading of the Bible. But, you know, we've been at that for 400 years that way. And that's certainly what my seminary education was all about. We focused on the book of Romans all the time. Now, when the question, the presenting question for much of the church is, how do people who are committed to different ideologies come to the table together? That's Paul's question. Jew, Gentile, or you can name any pair like that in conflict. And the argument is that the truth of the gospel is way underneath the things that divide us. So in ecumenical circles, the question is always, is this a church dividing issue? And pretty much the argument in ecumenical circles is there are no church dividing issues. So we shouldn't escalate issues to make them church dividing. And Lutherans and Presbyterians are very good at that. Episcopalians not as much, but Episcopalians got their share of it too. Yeah. Yes.
So I even feel childlike when I say this, but the wrath of God and this angry God, well, it scares me. I mean, it's a barrier.
Well, God will not be mocked. God is God. God is, Abraham Heschel the Great Jew said, God is no nice uncle.
I think I want a nice uncle.
Well, good for you. Well, so do we all.
I like that in Isaiah better.
Well, there are parts of Isaiah you wouldn't like. What you have to recognize is that the Old Testament articulates God with a wide spectrum of emotional possibility. And you can't just do this or do this or do this, but you know, we have to try to see what's this like, because we say we are made in the image of that God who has a huge emotional spectrum of possibility. And I think it's a very difficult pastoral task to do that. On the one hand, that doesn't scare us to death, but on the other hand, that doesn't make God into a nice warm fuzzy that we can carry about in our pocket or in our liturgy or in our creed. Because this is God. Alan Payton, the great South African novelist, wrote a poem for his son at confirmation, and it's a long poem, but in it he says, do not think that God is smarter than Socrates. Do not think that God is more gifted than Beethoven. God is not smarter than Socrates. God is not more gifted than Beethoven. He is their God. So we cannot draw God into our categories. And I think what this poetry wants to do is to keep going like that. So what we are invited, you and me, what we are invited to do is to write the next verse to these poems and to stay with it and see how it might unfold given everything we know about the tradition. So I don't know that we have to dwell on the wrath of God, but we do have to dwell on the fact that there are givens in the orderedness of creation that we cannot mock. You know, we learned in the last two generations You cannot smoke and smoke and smoke and probably not pay for it. You can't. You can't have what you want. You can't have life on your own terms. And what these prophets are talking about, and Jeremiah's talking about, Jerusalem tried to have life on its own terms. And they found 1,000 ways to say, you can't do that. So we have to work it out. You know, what ought we to say now? You want to come back at that? You heard me being in solidarity with you.
Oh, yes, yep. Absolutely.
Okay.
Absolutely.
Yep.
I think where it becomes more difficult is when you see crises played out in people's lives, when you see, you know, is that the will of God?
I understand that. Yeah. Yeah. I don't want to draw these poems into immediacy. The poems are not to be applied. Are to be lived with. And where does it take you? And what do you notice that you wouldn't have noticed without this poetry?
And perhaps that is the error that I think is taking some of this and applying it.
Like, yeah. Specifically. And people, I understand people do that. And I may do it sometime. I don't think that's what we ought to do. I just think we need to live with it. But to live with it means we got to slow down with some other stuff to make time for that. Otherwise, we want to reduce it to bumper stickers. And bumper sticker theology is not worth a damn, I think. Say more?
No, good, thank you.
Well, we got one other bunch of texts that I'll do quickly. What time we got here? Oh, we got a little time. At the end of the book, in 46 to 51, there's a whole different genre that scholars call oracles against the nations. But nations, in which God's sovereign rule is pronounced over all the nations. You remember in 1:10, God said, I have appointed you a prophet over the nations. So 46 is Egypt, and 50 is Babylon. These are the two superpowers. So a superpower at the beginning of the collection and a superpower at the end of the collection, and in between, a bunch of little states, they all get their share. But the last one is in 50-51, Babylon should say Egypt, 50-51 is the accent point. It's about Babylon, who has destroyed Jerusalem and has carried away the leading citizens. So what's going to happen to Babylon? Because we cannot go home as long as Babylon stays in power. Now, just a little side note. If you look in Jeremiah 25, this is a little freebie that you can dazzle your Bible-believing friends. In the Greek translation, all of chapters 46 to 51 is inserted between 25:13 and 25:15. So if you look at 25:13, it says, I will bring, 14, for many nations and great kings shall make slaves of them, and I will repay them for enslaving Israel. And then all of this, in that rendering, is God's repayment to these people. But what I want to talk about is Babylon. So if you look in 50, this is stuff we never read. Well, I want you just to see some of these. 50 verse 2. Declare among the nations and proclaim, set up a banner and proclaim, do not conceal it, say, quote, Babylon is taken! That's what they said in Czechoslovakia when the Soviet Union fell. That's what they keep hoping for in some Central American states about the great colossus of the north. Baal, that's a Babylonian god. Baal, form of Baal, is put to shame. Merodach, that's another Babylonian god, is dismayed. Her images, they smash the idols, and her idols are dismayed. Out of the north, that's Persia. Iran. Iran is attacking Iraq. Persia is attacking Babylon. Verse 8, flee from Babylon. Go out of the land of the Babylonians and be like male goats leading the flock, for I am going to stir up. So the image is that God stirs up the international pot. You wouldn't want to think that God had stirred up Al-Qaeda, but you might want to think God had stirred up China. Something has stirred up China. So if you were Chinese, you might want to say that. I doubt we want to say that. And then I wanted you to see these two amazing rhetorical units in 50. Verse 25, there are two chapters of gloating that Babylon is going to be destroyed, and when Babylon is destroyed, we can go home. So 50:35, a sword against the Babylonians, against the Chaldean Babylon synonyms, a sword against her intelligence community, her diviners, a sword against her warriors, a sword against her horses and against her chariots and against her foreign troops, her mercenaries, a sword against all of her treasures. And the most humiliating thing you can think, probably now too, but certainly then before don't ask, don't tell, and on back, the worst thing you can say about a soldier is that they're acting like women. So they may become like women. It's very patriarchal. And then if you look at the RSV footnote in 38, the word drought is the same word as the word sword with different vowels. So sword, 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 drought. A drought is a sword. That her land may be dried up, for it is a land of images. So this is a kind of a rah, rah cheerleading of hate and resentment and despising for hated Babylon that has kept us from home for two, three generations. I think it was like that when the peasants stormed the Marcos Palace in Manila. Such incredible resentment that they just wanted to seize the treasure and run roughshod over it. And so it's the endless story of tyrants. And no tyrant can last to perpetuity. Now, I suppose there are many ways to think about how tyranny comes to an end. But if you're writing poetry about God, you're going to say, God caused all this, because there's no other power that we can imagine. And then in 51:20, you, I think meaning Israel, you are my war club. With you I smash nations, with you I destroy kings, with you I smash horse and rider, with you I smash man and woman, I smash old man and boy, with you young man and the girl I smash, with you I smash farmers and their team and smash. It's just poetry. But it's devastating poetry in which the listeners are invited to imagine, this is an act of hope, that the world will not continue this way because the God of fidelity will not put up with it. Now, you don't have to explain anything that way. There are many other explanations. But if you confess the creed, which essentially says that God's got the whole world in God's hands, they didn't linger over proximate causes. Now I want you to look in Revelation 18. Verse 2, fallen, fallen is Babylon. Only now it's Rome. It's a Roman Empire. It has become a dwelling place of demons, of foul spirit, foul bird, foul and hateful beast, and blah, 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 blah. So the imagination of the old text is reassigned. And that's how the Bible is used. Whether that's right or not, it's used that way about every tyrant. And that chapter ends in verse 21 with such violence. Babylon, the great city, will be thrown down, will be found no more. The sound of harpists and minstrels and flutists and trumpets will be heard no more. An artisan of any trade will be found in you no more. The sound of the millstone of grinding flour will be heard no more. The light of a lamp will shine on you no more. The voice of the bridegroom and the bride will be heard no more. And in you was found the blood of prophets and saints because they killed all the dissenters. Well, that's extreme rhetoric in the New Testament. You see, one of the costs of wanting God just to be nice is that God becomes a private family God who has nothing to do with the public process. And what the prophetic tradition always wants to insist upon is that God's purposes are alive and powerful in the public process, so that God cannot be mocked in the public process any more than God can be mocked in our interpersonal relationships. And it takes a very robust rhetoric to get that done. Now I want to show you one narrative and then I'll be done. At the end of 51, the upshot of all of this is we're going home. We're going home. Well, before I do that, look in, find 2 Kings 25. I want to show you how these books end. They're all historical accounts. In 2 Kings 25, 27, in the 37th year of the exile of King Jehoiakim, that's 562, we could do the numbers, but you can trust me. What it shows is that the exiled Jerusalem king is still in exile, but he's still recognized as a king. So there's hope. Now, look in 2 Chronicles 36. We never read Chronicles, not without reason. What I want to tell you about Chronicles 36, this is the last chapter of the Hebrew Bible. This is the last thing in the Bible. 36:22, in the first year of Cyrus, king of Persia, in the fulfillment of the words spoken by Jeremiah, this is the Bible alluding to the Bible, the Lord stirred up the spirit of King Cyrus of Persia, so that he issued an edict. Quote, thus says King Cyrus, Yahweh, the God of heaven, has given me all, he was a great new superpower, and he has charged me. So Cyrus paid for the rebuilding of the temple in Jerusalem because it was a tax collecting agency for him. And he said, whoever is among you, May the Lord be with him, let him go up, you can go home. So the Jewish Bible ends with homecoming. Now, back to Jeremiah 51. I said 52, 51. 51, 59, this is wonderful. This is the last thing. You could see the very last line before 52, thus far the words of Jeremiah, this must have been the end of the book of Jeremiah. The word that the prophet Jeremiah commanded Sariah, if you trace that, that's a brother of Baruch. Jeremiah wrote on a scroll, chapters 50, 51, all the disasters that would come on Babylon, all the words were written concerning Babylon. Jeremiah said to Sariah, read these words, read chapter 50 and 51, and say, O Lord, you yourself threatened to destroy this place so that neither human beings nor animals, when you finish reading this scroll, get this, tie the scroll to a rock and throw it into the middle of the Euphrates, which was the boundary of Babylon. And as the scroll sinks into the Euphrates, thus Babylon shall sink to rise no more. So I think the only words that are not translated are when the scroll sank, it went bloop, 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 the word of the Lord. Say it with me. Bloop, 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 bloop. And we're free. We can go home. That's a pretty good outcome, isn't it? Yes.
I have a question about how many of the diaspora came back with the people returning to build the temple.
Well, we know that some of them didn't come back. Some of them had made a place for themselves in the Babylonian economy and thought they could be a Jew without going to Jerusalem, because what counted was the Torah, not the temple. And if you read the book of Ezra, you get the impression this was a small elite bunch of people who were going to control the future. And I think you can make the case then that already then was a dispute in Judaism about what constitutes a Jew. Is it being in Israel, or is it keeping Torah? And of course, that's the discussion that's going on in Judaism right now. But the Hebrew Bible, which became our Old Testament, is written by the fanatics. And the fanatics insist that our experience, we who went to Babylon and came home, our experience is normative for all Jews. So it takes a lot of chutzpah to make that case. But you could almost say that's how the church has always gone wrong when somebody insists that their experience is normative and is defining for everyone else in the church. And we call those denominations. Other comments?
At the beginning, you mentioned that the destruction, as you parallel that with what happened on 9/11. So where are we in the process of Jeremiah post 9/11?
Well, I would say we're still in denial.
Denial.
Yeah.
Not in exile.
No. I don't think we've gone there yet.
Yeah.
I don't think we've faced up to the way the world is changing. And we kind of engage in nostalgia for how we think it used to be. That's what I think. And of course, every politician promises he or she will be the one that will bring all that back.
There are a lot of prophets out there who are busy telling us that the world is changing. Yep. A lot of people tell, you know, and yet there's a large group of people who aren't heeding that.
That's right. And the problem then and now is that there's no answer in the back of the book to find out who the true prophets are. Yeah. But you see what theological traditions do, Episcopal or any of them, are try to extend the trajectory of our long-term interpretive posture into the future. So you have to know that long-term tradition in order to see whether the trajectory is faithful to that tradition. And every denomination, every interpretive trajectory is trying to find a way to move into the future. I had lunch with a pastor of we would call a not an established denomination. This guy, the pastor's got a growing church. He's 45 years old. He had theological training. He said it was no one had ever suggested to him until he was 40 years old that the gospel had to do with justice. It was like a huge disclosure. So, you know, we all live in our tradition, and some of our traditions are better than other traditions, but they're all defining and at some point restrictive, probably. And that's how we do it, well, all of us. Yeah.
Well, isn't it true that Jonathan Kahn, in his book, The Harbinger, is equating 9/11 to Isaiah 9 through 11?
Repeat the question, please.
Jonathan Kahn, in his presidential breakfast statement, has written a book called The Harbinger, who is relating 9/11 to Isaiah 9, 9 through 11.
I think he tries to apply it in ways that I find difficult. Mm-hmm. But that is what he's doing. Mm-hmm. That's right. He hangs an awful lot on one or two verses, it seems to me. So yeah. I just read it, so yeah, right.
Walter, given the issue that you've raised about our own denial, is this why it takes whoever put Jeremiah together, this is why they spent 29 chapters before they got to the passages we got to today, that you have to tell them something once and then twice and then three times?
I think that's right. That's right. Because the dominant theological tradition of chosenness in the Old Testament was so powerful that the data on the ground could hardly penetrate it. And you know, I don't have any problem seeing parallels to that. Our American ideology, which has worked so well for us, really is defining for us liberals and conservatives. And to take seriously data to the contrary is exceedingly problematic, and we don't want to sit still for anybody to remind us of that, I think. Yeah.
The whole issue of the covenant being renewed, you know, that we fall and then we renew it again, over and over and over again. And I'm not sure if anyone watches the Colbert Report or the Daily Show, but someone pointed out on one of those shows that whoever's the head of the EPA, whatever Republican congressman is, said that global warming is not an issue because God had made a covenant with Noah that he would never destroy the earth again, and so we didn't have anything to worry about.
Yeah.
And, you know, it's out the renewing of the covenant, I was thinking, oh yeah, well, you might want to renew the net before.
Yeah, yeah, yeah. But you see, if you entertain the thought that biblical faith is basically a contest for fidelity on God's part and Israel's part and the world's part, the only way you can maintain fidelity is through an endless process of breaking and remaking and breaking and remaking. If you got a package of certitudes, you don't have to do that. But fidelity is not a certitude. It's a risk and a process at which one has to keep working. And so these poets imagine God to be working in that way always, of getting angry and reaching out and getting angry and reaching out and so on. Yeah. And there are scholars who argue that the old pattern of covenant really became the ground of democratic political theory, because it was eventually a protest against absolutism. And even God is drawn into this relationship and must deal with a partner. And that becomes the taproot of democracy.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. Big D or little D on that?
Little. Yeah. Little. Very little. Well, I'm going to go home and find out whether my team is going to get out of exile.
So much to love about what you present in all these series you do for us. But for me personally, the thing that I'm so taken by is how infectious your enthusiasm and passion is for the Bible. So much so that it makes me want to go home and read it. Is the key for us. So I want to thank you for that. Heather?
First thing, the score is tied 0-0. No hits.
That's the most we can hope.
Better than we can hope. Walter, there is no adequate way to thank you for all you do for us and for the presentations you give. But this is just a little something with our thanks.
Thank you very much.
You're right.
Let's close with a prayer. The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Let us pray. God, we are once again reminded that you are God and you are the one who reigns over all creation. We thank you for Jeremiah. We thank you for his courage. We thank you for his willingness to be faithful to you and to speak the truth to your people. We thank you for Walter and his willingness to grapple with these texts and to help us to see how you are at work, how you can touch us and touch this world. As we continue to read your word in the days ahead, give us an openness to wherever this will take us. May we not be stuck in our certitudes, but be open to the risks at hand. And may we know that you are a God who will bring us out of the abyss and give us new hope this day and forevermore. Amen. Amen. Thank you for coming. Have a great evening.